Good afternoon, everybody. It is Tuesday, so it is time for a family support Q&A, and we have our really good friends from the Down Syndrome Association with us today. So without further ado, let's do some quick introductions. I want you to meet both Don and Erin. So Erin, why don't you tell us a little bit about you and your relationship to the Down Syndrome Association and to Down Syndrome?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having us today. I'm really excited. And we do love our friends at the St. Louis ARC. So we're really grateful to be guests today. My name is Erin Suelmann. I am the executive director of the Down Syndrome Association of Greater St. Louis. And I started here almost 10 years ago as a director of programs. And that's my background. I have a degree in public health. About 4 years later, I started as the executive director. So in 2016, I was promoted to executive director. And I've been doing that ever since. And I love it. I love getting to lead the team and think about the strategic vision of the organization. My love for our community comes from my brother, who is 36. His name's Andrew. Some of you may know him. And he has Down syndrome. So he's been involved in the St. Louis ARC and Down Syndrome Association and lots of other wonderful organization programming. So that's a little bit about me.
Thank you so much. And Don, this is our first chance to meet. So welcome. Yeah.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Don Williams. I've been with the DSA here now a little over 2 years. And my connection to the DSA, their employment program, which is now the program that I oversee primarily, as well as helping out with the different programs that we offer, is I was working at a company where we hired one of the first graduates of the Employment Academy through the DSA. And as I was told when that process was happening, that hiring this gentleman would change the culture of our company, and it absolutely did. And then about 2 years after that, all the moons aligned where the opportunity when this employment position became a full-time position, and I interviewed, and Miss Erin brought me on board. So it's been a blessing ever since.
Oh my goodness, Don, you were an employer first. So I might ask you some questions about that, because I think employers sometimes don't really believe us when we tell you it's going to be a culture change and it's going to be the best hiring decision you ever made. So I'm going to circle back to that. Before I do, though, I think it's important that everybody listening knows that we really are collegial partners here. And we asked Erin and Don to join us today for a couple of reasons. World Down Syndrome Day is coming up March 21st. And then it's also Employment First. I don't know if it's Employment First Month. It's just Employment First always, I think, as far as we're concerned. So we wanted to talk about employment through the lens of the DSA. But before we do that, I think it'll be best if Erin can give you guys an idea of the breadth of the services that are available at the Down Syndrome Association. So Erin, take it away.
A little bit about who we are. I think there is the misconception that the Down Syndrome Association just serves new babies and new families with Down syndrome. And that may have been true at one point, but a lot has changed. So I'm excited to tell you about all of the things that we do now. We were started about 45 years ago, as most organizations start, by a group of very motivated and inspired parents who became advocates for their children. We celebrated our 45th birthday last year. We serve about 1,900 families in the Greater St. Louis region. So when I say Greater St. Louis region, that means about 150-mile radius of the city of St. Louis. We serve pretty much all of eastern Missouri and southern Illinois to the best of our ability. With a small staff, you can see we have 11 staff people. And we are headquartered in Brentwood. We just moved to a new space here over in Hanley Industrial Court in Brentwood, and we love our new space. Our mission is to serve, support, and celebrate the lives of individuals with Down syndrome and their families through every stage of life. And our vision is an inclusive community in which all people with Down syndrome can reach their full potential. So a little bit about the services we offer. Again, our goal is to help families and help individuals with Down syndrome reach their full potential. And that takes We do that through a variety of programs and services. So the most important thing I think that we have always done is that new family support. We're the only organization in the region that is only dedicated to people with Down syndrome from birth through end of life. So we welcome about 50 to 60 babies annually, and we connect with those families with a prenatal diagnosis or when their baby is born. And that comes through hospital referrals, genetic counselor referrals, or a family just finding us when they get the diagnosis. We provide celebration baskets, we do home visits, hospital visits, but really connecting as soon as we can with those families to get them off on the right foot. And that means sharing healthcare guidelines, resources about our good friends, visiting with ARC and other organizations in the region, and early intervention therapies. We also send out first birthday gifts and cards. We send a birthday card to everybody with Down syndrome in the database. We have an ages and stages program, so we proactively send important resources at key milestone birthdays for families. So whether that's about puberty or transitioning out of high school, behavior, we try to get those resources in the hands of families before they know they need them. We have a mentor program and just lots of events where we can connect families together, because we know that the greatest source of information is oftentimes each other. We have other family events throughout the year. So we have a holiday party. We have a family picnic in the spring and calendar photo events. We have community groups. So again, one of the things that we know is that we have a small staff, but we serve a really large geographic radius. So we try to build community groups in regions that are geographically distant from the DSA to help families connect and have their own events that we support financially. We also have groups that are for specific subgroups of our population. So we have a group for Spanish-speaking families, we have a group for African-American families, and we have a group for families whose children have a dual diagnosis of Down syndrome and autism. We're also starting a siblings group, a siblings of adults with Down syndrome group, which I know the ARC has a great one as well. And then we have just kind of some other groups around the region that people can join if they're interested. A lot of what we do, which I know Sharon and Anne do a ton of at the ARC, is this answer questions. So we are here as a resource. Anything a family needs or a community member needs relates to Down syndrome throughout the life stages, we are here as a resource. And oftentimes we are referring back to the ARC if we don't know the answer or we don't provide that service. So as Sharon said, truly collaborative. And I think that's what makes the Sequoia area so amazing for families. Here's just a couple of adorable pictures of our little babies, our family events, and our new mother's luncheon. Again, we offer programs for every step of life. We have programs for small steps. Some of these have been postponed due to COVID, but we're excited to get them back up and running in various forms. We have a play group that actually is really cool. One of our moms organized this, and she moves around the region to different playgrounds. She has a Facebook group, and you can join the Facebook group, and she puts out a poll. And so you can participate in that poll and say, this is the playground I want to go to, and this is the date that works for me. So really awesome connection there. And that's for, you know, school age and little kids. We have online music therapy with Andy on Mondays. We used to do a summer therapy camp, so we're hoping to get that back this summer in some form. Our next step group, that is kind of school age. We do a lot of educational advocacy, as I know the ARC does as well. You can ask us questions about anything you have going on from an educational standpoint. And we also have an education specialist program. So training the teachers in the community to build inclusive classrooms for children with Down syndrome. We have Rock 21, which is a really popular music program, an online ukulele club, improv, which is just an amazing program, and lots of other virtual programs I'll show you here in just a minute. Our Steps to Independence programming is really about skill building. This really started growing when COVID first happened 2 years ago. We started a lot of programs online, and then we have been lucky enough to bring those in person, some of them, now that COVID numbers are going down again. And I'll let Donna talk a little bit about all the amazing in-person programs we offer for older teens and adults. And finally, our Ready to Work employment program and the pop-up marketplace, 3-2-1 Roasting, which I'll also let Don talk a little bit about. And then finally, we recognize that people with Down syndrome are living longer than ever. And so like the St. Louis ARC, we are really dedicated to ensuring families have resources for their aging loved ones. And oftentimes that's a sibling like myself who is now caring for their adult sibling. Or it's parents who are kind of coming to that stage in their life where they need to start thinking about transition. So we're building programs around dementia prevention, skill building, and just resources for families as they age. This is a little glimpse of our winter virtual schedule, program schedule. Some of these are in person. And all these links are online, which I know we will share for you. So I encourage you to check out our website. Here's some pictures of some of the fun things we do. Fundraising and awareness. So we do, of course, a lot of fundraising events. One of our largest events is on June 5th, our Step Up for Down Syndrome event. That is our largest awareness event of the year. So much fun. So we're gearing up for that. And then, of course, you know, ways to get involved. We have World Down Syndrome Day coming up on 3/21. That is going to be such a fun day. We're going to have an open house here at the office. So activities for little ones in the morning, including a music therapist from Midwest Music Therapy, and activities in the afternoon for our for anybody. But we're kind of gearing that around our teens and adults. Down Syndrome Awareness Month is October. And then, you know, of course, just other ways to volunteer and get involved with what we have going on. Here are our social media handles on our website. If you want to follow us, I would say Facebook is probably the best way to stay in touch with us and find out what's going on. We're building our Instagram presence. And then here is our address and our phone number. So again, give us a call if you have any questions about what we do or how to get services from the DSA.
So much information. Wow. I feel like I've been doing this a long time and you had lots of things in there that sparked my interest that I didn't have a lot of information about. Don, you said earlier you were a previous employer. Now you're doing the employment programming and I love the pop-up program. So I love it if you spend a few minutes just telling everybody about some of the emphasis you all have placed on employment and how you are helping people build skills and find great jobs.
Okay. Well, it is, it's been proven through a lot of studies, and it's certainly our belief that folks with Down syndrome and many others with disabilities are the most underserved in the employment community. So our efforts were to help bridge that gap and do initially some basic skill training and customer facing training. So at least, if nothing else, through that process and as we make introductions to hiring managers, our candidates would be a little more prepared and ready to go as opposed to starting from square one. In that early phase, that's where the pop-up snack shop idea came in. We started off with kind of a basic snack shop premise. We'd go to businesses over like a lunch hour period, maybe for 90 minutes. And that gave us the opportunity to do every element of curating and packing the snack boxes, loading up the van, unloading, creating the displays, and then waiting on the customers. Tear it down, take it back to the office. So there were several skills, some as simple as you would think initially, that we had to learn how to create visuals for and other training methods. And then, but that proved to be really great. And then we had like an internal mentorship. So as we bring new folks in, those that had mastered these skills would have them show the others, here's how we build the display here for the munchies, you know, that kind of thing. We were really, right before COVID, we were taking off by the first week of March of 2020, we had scheduled over 75 pop-up visits that we were going to make throughout the year at the different business partners that we had. So then we had to regroup. So at the early part of last year, we started just because we had all hoped by at least by 2021, we'd be back to work. So we began our Employment Academy training virtually. And so we had about a 3-month course of that in hopes that, geez, by June, it has to break loose. But through that process, that was very helpful for us because we learned some things. Not only could we reach others that maybe it wouldn't have been convenient to come to the office initially based on where they lived in proximity to the office, but also it helped us, as many of the other things we were doing virtually, it helped us not only reach a different group of candidates, but it also gave us new ways to learn how to communicate and how to develop skills, even virtually, even when they're not there. One of the things that we worked on that we're so proud of that is now part of our current in-person program that we are launching next month, which we're very excited about, was teaching our candidates how to present themselves in, like, in an interview setting. We give them 2 or 3 primary questions to learn how to answer, why they're ready for a job, kind of a version of a mini elevator pitch, if you will. And that proved to be so emboldening of our candidates. When they got in front of the group, when we were doing that Zoom, we said, all right, you're next. Tell us why you're ready. And they would present what they had worked on for the coming weeks. It was just fabulous. And so from that, we're going to create video resumes for them. So on their resume, they'll have a QR code that will have the little video that we'll make as they graduate from the Employment Academy. And so we think that is an amazing first step as we get in front of hiring managers, say, as we schedule an interview, for example, or at least a meeting with someone, we can email them this information and they can already get a little piece of information about that candidate, see them, see how they communicate, what they believe their skills and readiness are. And so we believe that'll be an amazing first step as we start getting back in the workplace.
That is so cool. I never thought about doing the video resume with a QR code. Super, super smart. I love it. See, this pandemic has given us some gifts. We just have to know how to use them. Right. You know, I just don't get it because I've had the same experience and I know the data as to why there's the people with Down syndrome are underhired even within the disability community. And I think discriminated against. Erin, you mentioned inclusive education as well. And I think I just find that to be so confusing. And I'm curious, and I don't know which of you, I kind of want to talk to both of you about it because I want to know why these myths are pervasive about the capacity of people with Down syndrome. So Erin, maybe you can talk about that, but then Don, I want to shift back to you and kind of ask about your role as an employer. What surprised you when you started interviewing people with Down syndrome, and what did you learn once you hired somebody? So you think about that, Erin. Okay. Why is there this expectation for people with Down syndrome?
Oh gosh, that's such a good question, Sharon. I think when you said talking about inclusive education, that's really spot on. It starts really early, right, with myths and misconceptions about people with disabilities, all different types of disabilities. And Down syndrome is just a pretty visible disability. So usually when you see somebody with Down syndrome, you recognize that they have a disability. So I think the key to creating a more inclusive environment and a more inclusive community is starting when people are children and having more exposure. And so then when you are a hiring manager, you do work at a business, you can say, I went to school with somebody with Down syndrome and they were awesome. I went to prom with them, or, you know, they were on my basketball team. So I think that's really, really important. And we're building that, we're growing that, you know, all of our organizations are working on that and families. I think that there's a fear factor. I think employers don't know how to fit people in. Even the best people with best of intentions and the most well-meaning just don't know how to do it, or they're afraid to do it in fear that they might mess up or they might not, you know, have the right accommodations or do something wrong. And so that is why I feel like our organizations are so important to helping, not going in and demanding that people hire people with disabilities, but offering them the support that they need to do so. Because I do think that there are a lot of employers out there that would be willing and open to it. I feel like that's one of the nice things about our pop-up marketplace. And Don, did you mention our coffee roasting? I feel like maybe you didn't mention our 3-2-1 coffee roasting, which is a great product. So we're out there, you know, we're peddling our wares, but the whole purpose is that folks can have interactions with people with Down syndrome and start the conversations about, you know, Andrew, for instance, my brother. Andrew, you know, he's so good at customer service and he's really loyal and oh, man, he, you know, it's not charity. It is legitimately hiring somebody that can bring real value to your team. And that's what Don is really skilled at doing with our pop-up is starting those conversations with employers. And I think, you know, it's also a matter of finding, sorry, I get really passionate about these things. It's so important to find the right fit too. You know, you have, mm-hmm. and we don't serve, you know, hundreds of people every year because we feel like if we can do one person at a time and get one person the perfect job, they will be successful. And that is such a success story to be able to share with other employers.
Job matching is everything. Yeah. All right, Don, back to you.
All right.
Do you roast coffee at the DSA, Don?
That is a perfect segue. I was saving the 3-2-1 roasting for the big
thing. Didn't know what he was saying that for.
I'll jump in on that. We couldn't take our pop-up, obviously, over the last couple of years. We couldn't go visit businesses. And so last summer, we entered into a partnership with a local coffee roaster. So, and they were very instrumental. They came up with the idea. We're not going to supply you with coffee for these events. We're going to show you how to do it and make it part of your employment program. So it was actually more their brainchild. And so they helped set us up and it has really been a blessing. It's exploded for us. And what has been great about it as the word has slowly gotten out, then there've been other little side projects that tie in. We've got another local partner that they do a lot of craft work. And so they came in and we are on our third batch of having our team paint white coffee cups with our logo. And they paint them with the special and they, you know, fire blaze them, whatever that process is called. And they look amazing. So now it's not just a bag of coffee. We have coffee cups and all
here's
this.
My mug.
Yeah, and we have
tumblers. Oh, that's awesome.
My tumbler. Yeah, we'll send you one.
So is that stuff available both at the pop-up and through your website?
Yes.
Okay, we have a question. I don't want to ignore the questions from folks. They want to know if there's a schedule of pop-ups. If I must have pop-up snacks, where can I come and find them?
Well, we have a permanent display at the DSA office in Brentwood that shows our couple samples of our gift boxes, because we've obviously been able to grow into that concept. We right now, our program is with help from our local roaster, we roast Colombian beans in a medium roast. And then we have ground or whole bean. And one of our members, Miss Julie, has tremendous artistic capabilities. So she made three logos for us, so to speak, using a general pattern. And then everyone on the team voted one Friday at one of our in-house events and they voted which one was their favorite. So that became our logo. So then we ordered stickers. And so the beauty of the program quickly is from the roasting element to the packing, which was quite an amazing thing. It took us like 3 or 4 packings to figure out just what formula. Because taking ground coffee and trying to get it in a little bag and fold it up.
Yeah.
I needed someone to teach me before I could show them. So it wasn't easy, but we got there. And now those that have been through the process, they're fabulous at it. And so all of those elements along that way, like I said, they put the stickers on. And then once the bag is packed, they write their name on the back. So you know who packed that bag of coffee. It's very fun for us.
Oh, that's cool. Yep. And you know what? I think every person deserves the opportunity to fumble around and learn how to do something new and then feel that sense of accomplishment you get when the coffee ends up in the bag. God knows I have spilled coffee all over the place myself, and I feel good once I figure out how to get it right. So I think we all We all want that. And the only way to have that happen is to have opportunities.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, so in answer to the question too, if you want to schedule a pop-up, we can go out. We are starting to do that now that we have the ability. So Don can get a group and go out to a business, or like he said, we were just at the Brentwood or the Richmond Heights vendor market, which was really fun. Yeah. So we can do that. And then you can definitely reach out to Don about ordering product as well.
Okay. I'm going to shift gears briefly. And then Don, I have not given up on talking to you as an employer, but we do have a question about the Zooms. So when people go through and click through the Zoom links, are those free opportunities for people?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. And I wonder if you guys have had the same experience that we have, where all of a sudden we've got regular participants in Atlanta and California and in other places. Have you kind of picked up a new audience for some of your materials?
Yes.
Yeah.
On Tuesdays, over 2 years ago, we started a program on Tuesdays at noon called Let's Talk. And, you know, because early on we were seeing elements of regression and stuff because nobody was getting out. You're just sitting in front of the, you know, media that you had. And so what began is just something, let's just try and encourage some dialogue and some conversation and try and stay connected while we're going through something none of us knew what to expect. It has now grown into some pretty crazy events. Today's was no exception. But today we had someone from Virginia, Springfield, Cape Girardeau, two people from Illinois, you know, like, plus a handful.
I think for an organization like yours that serves so many counties and you really can't physically be present, I didn't realize, Erin, that you guys provided money to the local communities to have community groups, but how great also that I can be in a rural part of Illinois and be able to zoom in and be a part of activities. So those are just really, really neat opportunities. Back to you, Don. I'm not going to give up on this. I just find the employer perspective to be so important for all of us. So when you were an employer, you know, what was worked for you as far as being willing to give people an opportunity? What did you learn through that experience? How can we all do better with our outreach to the employment community?
Okay. That's great. I have to, there's no question. I've shared this part of the story many, many times, is I had one of the employees, Miss Andy, who works with us, who was one of the early initiators of this program and helped get it off the ground with McKinney. I had a relationship with her at my previous employer. And so she introduced us to the program. And before we even met the candidate, she said, I'm going to come in, I'm going to talk with you and your employees that may be working with him and just help explain a few things, hopefully eliminate some of the hesitations and things that you may be nervous or scared about, or just, you know, what have you, help eliminate some of those emotions and just look forward to having just another contributor on your team. And so we said, okay. So we scheduled the interview. That was phase one. The gentleman was at our, in our store. We met he and I and the owner of our store. And within 5 minutes, the owner looks at me and goes, well, should we give him the tour? Which is basically he's hired. All right. So if you're not sure, that's all it took. I didn't tell him. I said, hey, we have an interview. There's something's really important. It's a friend of Andy's, who he also know her. And I think there's a place we just need to get him in here. So we obviously offered him a position. He accepted. Andy then came and had a meeting with us the day before he was to start. And the presentation, I remember many elements of it because it really just spoke to emotions that we were having in advance of it. None of us had, although we all knew someone or had an extended family member that may have had some type of disability, but never worked in a professional setting, if you will, with someone. And so we were nervous. We didn't want to say the wrong thing. We didn't want to ask them to do something they weren't capable of. You know, basically we just overthought just about every element of what a work relationship is. And that's probably pretty natural. So the first hint I would say is try your best to just be open-minded, and anyone who's going to help you, whether it's through our organization or any organization, we're going to have some tips and ideas, best practices to help you. So you can embrace the process and focus on the individual. They have so much to give. So then once we got Scott on board, it took a couple of days of him working in that setting where he became comfortable with us. And we tried to, in those early days, have the same scheduling. So all of us could at least initially, so we knew like on the Tuesday and the Thursday, we knew that there'd be these two or three people there. So that would be an easy transition. So we would all get a chance to, and that worked out well for us. And based on feedback from Andy through the DSA, we knew there were a handful of skills that would work well for him. So we train him on those, we get him going. We checked in with him throughout the day. Seems fine. What was really important for us though, was part of our nervousness was we all kind of do everything in the environment I was in. Like, and I think that's most places in today's world.
Right.
We all tend to wear several hats. So unknowingly, we were putting limitations in front of what this candidate may have been able to accomplish. But it didn't take long because once we got him trained up, he would stay on that task. And that was something Andy told us. You're going to find that they're dedicated, they're thorough, and once they know how to do something, they'll do it. And if it takes an hour, so, you know, a lot of times, you know, an average employee may get bored. I got to do this for an hour. They will hunker down and they will stick with it and do it consistently until the job or the project is completed. And this candidate bore that out, you know, in spades. It was really impressive. So it became obvious. What else can we have him do? I mean, he does a good job. He gets it done. He's not looking for a break in the middle. If it's not done, it's like, get it done. And so over time, you know, within 6 months, we more than doubled the different things that we had him doing around the store because he was capable. And it was basically us training ourselves on how best to and bring him in.
You must have told that story before, because you're right. It was a good one. You had a lot of great detail in there. And I do think people get discouraged because they're told we don't carve jobs for people. You have to come in here and be able to do everything. And I love that your approach to it was to start off with some continuity and to start maybe a little bit smaller, but then open your own minds up to all the possibilities that he brought to your workforce. And I think all of employers, you know, I read the paper, I read news blogs, there's a hiring problem right now. So if you're looking for a really great dedicated workforce and have not looked into the disability community, I encourage you to come and talk to the Down Syndrome Association, to the St. Louis ART, to other people that are providing these services, because we will be there to walk with you through that process and figure it out. I want to give each of you a chance to either promote one more thing or just say something to the community that you want to talk about. As I've been listening to you, I've been thinking about possibility, because I think we all have opened our own minds to the possibilities for people with disabilities, including Down syndrome. I know some of my friends with Down syndrome, both this year and next year, are going to college, which a few years back was not considered to be an option. And I see, you know, local people that are doing amazing things that happen to have Down syndrome. So I walk out of our conversation today just thinking about how big the possibilities are. So Don, I'm going to give you a minute, and then Erin, I'm going to have you wrap us up with whatever you want to say.
All right. Well, I'd like to piggyback what Erin said. I have two ideas. One, find out more about our 3-2-1 roasting and our employment, whether you're someone that's looking for a position, whether you're someone who might be interested in hiring someone, or you just really want to drink some really tasty coffee, then we are your place. The second thing I'm excited about is we are in the final days of finalizing a new program for next quarter that's going to start in the second week of April. New activities in person, a couple of new Zooms, things from improv, lifelong learning skills. We have a program called Fusion Fridays that we're back in person. And it is kind of group activities to encourage communication, comprehension, team building, if you like that as well. And it has been one of the most amazing. I mean, the office it's hard for them to get any work done because we pretty much take over for a couple hours. And so those are the types of things that we are so blessed to be able to facilitate. And if you have any interest in joining that, pay close attention. That programming page link that came up earlier, all that information will be on there in the coming days.
I guess I'm just going to say that really do consider us a resource regarding anything. And we are here. Many of our staff members have children with Down syndrome of a variety of ages. So we have siblings on staff, we have educators. So just about anything you might need, we can either help you with, or we can get you to the right person who can help you. So we are always excited to hear from new families. And we are also a pretty dynamic organization in that if we are not offering something and we see that there's a need for it in the community, a lot of times, you know, I am the big idea person, and in the next staff meeting, I say, hey, I think we should do this program. And my amazing team is usually either tells me that it's a terrible idea, or they make it happen. So, you know, really, we are here as a resource and for anything anybody could possibly need. And I think 99% of our services are free of charge. So I think that's just all I have to say. And we hope to see you at one of our programs or online events. And thank you so much to all of you for having us today.
Yeah, for sure.
I do think that you offer so many wonderful resources to folks. So take advantage of those. Thank you again for coming today. Bye, everybody.
Thanks.